nothing beats, you know, my time in ECW. It was the greatest time of my life.
Word association. ECW, fun. End of story.
We were changing everything about wrestling. That's the way we felt, and that's what we believed.
It was like nothing I've ever seen before, and I became a fan instantly.
ECW was coming out with violence, and the crowd just ate it up.
Those fans were absolutely rabid.
The Philadelphia fans are some of the most vocal and, at times, most violent.
There were things that we couldn't do that Paul Heyman was able to do and attracted an audience because of it. That was smart.
He showed us that you could appeal to one segment of the audience and make a go of it.
I believe Paul E is one of the greatest minds in the history of wrestling.
I didn't think it was gonna fold. This was Paul's baby.
It just gave me a realization, appreciate what you have today, because it may not be there tomorrow.
Is more extreme than the Tasmaniac.
I knew Paul from just working independence through the Northeast, you know, in the late 80s, early 90s. Paul called me, and Paul said, well, listen, I got a date for you against this guy Sabu. Do you know who he is? I go, well, I've heard of Sabu. He said, well, I want you to wrestle him. You think you can have a good match with him? And at the time, I just wanted to get booked anywhere I could. So I said, yeah, sure, we'd have a great match, you know. I went to Philly and wrestled Sabu, and we had a pretty intense, very physical match.
These two men are a couple of animals. This match will be taking place in a zoo.
As far as getting any of the dates, I ended up working for Paul for about close to 7 years after that.
We have met a new force in NWA, Eastern Championship Wrestling. We have met the most animalistic wrestler in the history of this sport. We have met Sabu.
Sabu had developed a reputation in FMW in Japan. And I looked at Sabu and I was mesmerized by him because here was someone that had scars all over his body and a total disregard for his own well-being. And looks like he will fight you to the death. And to me, in developing the aura of ECW, Sabu was the main key to it all. Because here was a guy that we could put up his picture on television and people would say, yo, that's different.
Oh my God, Sabu! Here we go!
He was crazy and he was so innovative. The way you would use a chair as a weapon and jump from a chair to the top rope, do a moonsault. Things that Sabu physically could do are amazing.
And what this ECW is doing is educating you people once again that there is wrestling, spelled W-R-E-S-T-L-I-N-G, out there.
There would not have been an ECW without Terry Funk. He was the only veteran from that era who had the reputation of being legitimately tough, but also had the business sense to realize, I got to get the next generation ready for there to be a business, for there to be an industry for me to leave behind something too. And Terry had that mindset. A lot of the veterans back then were unwilling to get the young guys ready. A lot of the veterans were still clinging and clutching to their spot, to their reputation of being the top guy. I want to be the champion. I want to be the top guy. And Terry Funk just said, oh, I can make him. Oh, I can make him too. Oh, let me make him. I'll do something special with him. And did, with everybody that he worked with.
Look at this unbelievably hot rookie here, Tommy Dreamer.
I showed up with my bags, and Taz was booked, and I got to work, and I was employed for the entire time, for 7 or 8 years.
Now Taz with that chair. Dreamer blocked the shot and break the chair over the head of the Tasmaniac. Dreamer's hot now. Boy, this kid can fight. And a DDT on the floor. This kid is tough.
That was my heart and that was my passion. All I ever wanted to do was wrestle.
And a clothesline and floor tag. Wow, what an athlete.
I never wanted to pitch in Game 7 of the World Series. I never wanted to throw the touchdown in the Super Bowl. I wanted to wrestle and, you know, be a professional wrestler.
Look at these fans. They're actually applauding Tommy Dreamer. Can you believe it? In this, the most vicious, hardcore wrestling city in the world, Philadelphia? Unbelievable.
the Sandman, steep in his training regimen, they're doing some 12-ounce curls.
As much as anyone else, Sandman was the embodiment of Extreme Championship Wrestling. He was a huge part of our shows. The whole music entrance and smoking the cigarettes and drinking beer and smashing the beer can till he bleeds from the head before he ever starts the match. His matches became secondary. Here was just a tough guy looking for a fight. And people loved him.
And there's Tommy Dreamer. Sandman misses. Dreamer unloads on a Sandman. Tommy Dreamer to the rescue. All right. Women just came, Tommy Dreamer.
Around that time, Michael Fay was convicted of a crime in Singapore, and it was a big deal here in the United States. He was going to get caned, and how could America let someone get caned? We had the Sandman who walked around, and he was drinking beer and smoking cigarettes, coming to the ring. In the early stages of ECW, I was labeled a pretty boy, and Paul came up with the idea of a Singapore cane match, and the loser of the match had to get caned, and I lost.
Oh, I don't want to watch this. I can't look.
The first time he hit me, boom, I went down, the place cheered. Second time he hit me, the place cheered again. The third time he hit me so hard, they could start seeing my back start to bleed.
Dreamer has been busted open. He's bleeding across his back.
I remember the first couple of shots. They hurt like hell. And then after that, adrenaline kicks in. No matter how much I hurt and really wanted to stay down, there was nothing that would have made me.
Thank you, sir. May I have another?
And Dreamer opts for the cane.
I remember fans telling me to stay down. I remember two girls crying, just telling me to stay down. People I didn't know.
Oh, my God!
I just kept getting up and getting up, and it was brutal. And ECW preyed on human emotion with a lot of angles. Polk made that Rocky type of story. I remember facing off with the Sandman after that. And his lip was quivering because it was so emotional, and he was like, oh my God, you know, we're living this great moment right now. That was a turning point in my career, but it was also a turning point in ECW, where it was a form of redemption through violence for me and for the fans. It's the best drug in the world, that rush from the fans. And it's amazing. And that's what always kept me going, pretty much, with fans.
We did a lot of things with the Sandman and Tommy Dreamer that broke a lot of taboos. We did the thing where Tommy Dreamer had a cane match with the Sandman, and Dreamer knocked the cigarette into Sandman's eye and then caned Sandman in the other eye, and Sandman was blind, and we tore down the dressing room wall. And you saw both the good guys and the bad guys commingling over this hurt wrestler. And Tommy Dreamer saying, I'm sorry, I didn't mean to hurt you.
Hey, come on, just get out of here.
Get in my face, I didn't mean it.
Which was really taboo back then.
Bastard, come on, son of a bitch.
And then the Sandman, to his credit, stayed at home for a month so that nobody saw him around town. So that he didn't say, yeah, they're doing this thing where the Sandman's blind. He stayed home. He never left his house. He never answered his door. His wife answered the door. It was unheard of back then for somebody to stick to the storyline to this degree. And then the Sandman was going to retire and came out to the arena blind and peeled away the blindfold and caned the crap out of Tommy Dreamer. And it was one of the most shocking moments of the early days of ECW, and also one of the loudest, because boy, did that hook the audience.
I came to ECW from WCW as part of like a
a little bit of a talent exchange. There was a dream match that real hardcore wrestling fans wanted to see with me as Cactus Jack against Sabu, who was their top guy and doing some really revolutionary things. And WCW was attempting to establish a relationship with them, and they thought sending me over for this dream match would be a good way to kind of further the relationship.
Cactus Jack Mick Foley came to ECW the first time for a lawsuit between ECW and WCW, and was part of a settlement or an agreement that was made.
Mick and I always wanted to do business together, and we worked with each other in WCW. And then when ECW came along and there was an opportunity for us to work together, we both jumped all over it.
Now, I got a lot of heat for spitting on the WCW tag belts. I still maintain that people in charge would not have been so upset, Ric Flair in particular, if they'd actually seen the interview instead of just hearing about it. Because it was what I was doing. I was saying the tag team belt was important to me, but not as important as my pride, which I felt like I had lost that night at the ECW arena. I was told, hey, help these guys out. And I wanted to help them out not only with what I could do in the ring, but with what I could do on the mic. And I thought Sabu deserved to be established as the top guy, and I thought I'd do what I could to make that happen.
And there goes Sabu!
Mikey Whipwreck was part of our ring crew. And these kids worked on the ring crew for free as long as they could fly around the ring a little bit and just be noticed. And we noticed Mikey Whipwreck, and he was 19 years old, and he would take a bump, and he had such sympathy. And so we asked him if he'd like to wrestle, and he said, oh my God, it's my dream to wrestle. And he was trained, and so we put him in the ring, and the one key was we never gave him an offensive maneuver.
Mikey Whipwreck just taking the beating of his life. I've never seen this kid land a punch, a shot, a kick, anything on anybody ever. Pile driver on Mikey Whipwreck.
The next thing you know, he'd come out and the audience would just explode. And people fell in love with him.
Mikey, the public enemy is real, real mad. You know what that means?
It means I'm gonna die.
He likes it. Mikey really, really likes it.
He took the best beatings of anybody you'd ever seen. And people fell in love with him. I love the Raven character, and the Raven character motivated me. It inspired me to be more creative. Quote the Raven, nevermore. He could do anything that I imagined, and I had a performer that would grasp it and embrace it and have a passion for it, the likes of which I'd never seen before and may never see again.
Tommy Dreamer, who has fought so hard to achieve respect as a hardcore wrestler, cannot go on with his career. He is obsessed with beating Raven.
The feud between me and Raven was probably one of the best feuds in ECW for the simple fact of I never beat him. For 3 years, I never beat him. And every time I'd come so close, I would somehow just not pull it up.
Some punk that I've known since I'm 12 years old won't get out of my life. I can't get my hand raised, no matter how much I beat his ass.
We went to summer camp together as kids, and I was a high school jock who got along with everyone. He was an outcast, and he came back to get his revenge on me. He brought in a fat girl from camp who used to like me, and she came back as a Playboy playmate, as in Beulah McGillicuddy, and she wanted her revenge on me.
Oh my God!
Tommy had never been accepted by the audience. And Tommy went like this, and he did Raven's pose, and he tilted his head back, and the audience started chanting, he's hardcore, because they had been riding Tommy and riding Tommy. And finally, they took him in and accepted him.
Paul had allowed myself and Raven a lot of creative freedom, which is a blessing, because a lot of times you're just told, this is what you have to do. Here's someone telling you, what do you want to do? And you're like, what? it was Raven and Dreamer, but then we'd start incorporating other people like a Steven Richards, like the Blue Meanie, Beulah McGillicuddy, the Pitbulls, Brian Lee, and so many things spurned off of that. And so many people's lives were affected by it.
Time went on, Sabu and I, we ended up being partners and we won the tag team titles. Sabu and I did not get along. I couldn't stand him and he couldn't stand me, and that's the gospel truth.
Taz and Sabu, this is a feud. You can feel the hatred and it's only going to intensify.
I was really angry with Sabu when he left. What happened was, Sabu and I were going into a big match as partners, and Sabu had told me the week before that he was being booked in Japan. Make a long story short, we get to the ECW arena and Sabu didn't show up. So right before the show started, the fans were filing in. Paul Heyman had me walk to the ring with him and 911, who was like Paul's bodyguard type of guy, went in the ring and publicly fired Sabu. And that was the real deal.
One member of our dressing room gave us a commitment and decided that because he was offered more money on a weekly basis, that he will not waste you for what you paid to see. And he decided not to give me the courtesy of a phone call when he swore to God on Sunday night before we all went into production to give you the last Tuesday night's television show, when I said, if you're not going to be in the arena, if you're going to fuck the audience that made you a star in this country, let me know and I'll handle it on an interview. And he said, I swear to God, I'll be there.
Paul never lied to the fans. He lied to the wrestlers, but he never lied to the fans. Anything that the internet or any magazine or story that got out, Paul a lot of times would address. And he would do it by going to the ring and telling them.
In 1995, it was Fort Lauderdale, Florida, at the War Memorial. It was a tag team match. It was myself and Eddie Guerrero versus Dean Malenko and Too Cold Scorpio. And Scorpio and Malenko were taking it to me pretty good, and I was trying to tag in Eddie, and I couldn't get to Eddie. And I landed right on my forehead and just jacked my whole neck back, and that was it. And I was out for a year.
When Taz broke his neck in Florida, he finished his match, and he just kept on saying, damn, my neck is hurt. I walked him into the hospital, and we just, you know, we would always travel together, and they asked him, how'd you get in here? He's like, I walked. And they're like, there's no way you walked in here. And he's like, yeah, I did. I walked in here. And like, well, sir, you have a broken neck.
I was out for actually about 9 months, and Paul paid me every single week of our agreement and my guarantee. I didn't have no contract with the man. I had a handshake with the guy. And he stuck to that. And I will never, ever forget that. Paul was loyal to the crew. The crew remained loyal to Paul.
We started doing the Fabulous Ones, which were a famous tag team in Memphis for years. And Raven actually came up with the idea to start parodying people just to entertain himself and entertain the boys. And I did Baron Von Stevie, which was a takeoff of Baron Von Raschke. Imitated Public Enemy after they left and went to WCW.
Fly Boy Stevie Rock and Meanie Grunge. Public Enemy?
We were just doing a parody of the NWO from WCW because they were the hottest thing back then.
Pregnancy angle that we did. As I was beating him up, a fan also handed me a blueberry pie, and I just said hell with it, and I took a big bite of it, DDT'd him, laid him out, left with the girl. It was Shane Douglas that said that Beulah was cheating on me, and everyone thought it was with Raven or with another wrestler that I'd be then feuding with, and it turned out she was cheating on me with Kimona. In ECW, we did the first ever lesbian angle. In wrestling, we got thrown off of every television station that we had.